Доброго дня, вітаю всіх знову тут у Політурці. Я Андрій Альохін. Цьогоріч, якщо ви були...
Hello, welcome all to Program Binding. I'm Andrій Альохін, and if you've been to the Kyiv Book Arsenal this year, you must have seen the large veteran stand, where veterans turned writers signed their books. It was a very popular place, and one tall and fit writer with a dimple in his chin stood out. But he lacked both hands. He had a hook for one hand, like a pirate from a fairy tale. He used that hook to sign autographs for those who wanted to buy his books. It was the renowned Oleksandr Tereshchenko, a writer who wrote the now very famous book Life After 1630. The life of this person has developed in a fairly tragic way.
Олександр Терещенко, письменник, який написав
дуже... First, he volunteered to go to the front, was wounded and almost lost an eye, defending the Donetsk Airport. A grenade landed where he was hiding. He tried to catch it and throw it away so that none of the bystanders would be blown up. It was then that the grenade exploded and he lost both his hands. It is a horrible story. But aside from surviving, he managed to write a book, and not just a book, but a fun and interesting book with a good sense of humor about life after 1630 and about what happened after that incident. So we warmly welcome you to watch our program and meet today's guest Oleksandr Tereshchenko.
Він написав книжку, книжку веселу, книжку з гумором про те, яке життя після 16:30, після того, що сталося. Коротше кажучи, зустрічайте. У нас сьогодні в гостях Олександр Терещенко. Саша, ну от ваша книжка «Серед ветеранів».
So, Alexander, your book really stands out among books written by other veterans. Very much so. It is not so much about the war itself, but how to live on after the war. The idea you came up with was to write a book from scratch after returning home from a brutal war. Why did you decide to write about this subject? After all, earlier you were a videographer in Mykolaiv, if I... Yes, I spent most of my life on television, but I was no longer a cameraman right before the war. I was working as an engineer. I had absolutely no plan to write a book. I was an active user of Facebook, which is a very important term known as blogger. I wrote about all kinds of topics, the topic of the day, as they say. About a year ago, on May 18, I described the moment the grenade went off in my hands. It started with a bright flash, then there was an explosion, and then I fell. The injury didn't knock me out, so I remembered everything clearly, including various details. I just spilled almost everything out automatically. I posted it and received over 1,000 likes. They encouraged me and said everything was great. So I kept writing. I called those short stories nonsense. Nonsense number one. The second nonsense was about the intensive care. I promised myself that I would only write after the war. It was like a starting point, because my military biography was very short. It turned out that writing something about my past military career seemed to be beyond the point and totally irrelevant. So when I accumulated about 10 of those stories, the famous poet Vladimir Pushkov from Mykolaiv tried to encourage me to publish a book. He gave me my first literary criticism. I can see your scattered stories, so let's publish them. I think they will attract a huge reading audience. I asked him what material that I wrote could be published. The fact is that I had written about 10 to 15 stories and wasn't sure if I could write more. I didn't want to torture myself and did not want to force myself to do this. The work of a writer, something like that. By the way, when I studied in university and sometimes played the guitar, I decided that I was a poet. I put a notebook and pen by my bed when I went to sleep because I thought I would come up with some ingenious idea in my sleep, like Pushkin. I even wrote some rhymes. I didn't want that. So he said, let's try a newspaper. So we tried to get our works published in the Mykolaiv newspaper, then the Almanac. Then once I had written 38 stories and book was already printed and published, some of my stories did not even make it into the book because it had already been released.
Ми спробували в Миколаївській газеті, потім в Альманаху. А потім вже, коли почало доходити до книги, то я вже так розійшовся, і коли книга вже була готова, то навіть війшло 38 оповідань, а декілька вже не встиг, тому що вийшла книга.
Well, you know, I think that there will be a second edition, and maybe a third one, because I saw people at the book arsenal who visited the veteran stand. Veteran literature is very popular today, and many people were specifically trying to find you and your nonsense, because social media is a powerful force. And you're a real celebrity there. People read your books. They know you. They looked for you, waited for you, bought, read, and reread your books. If you say there are new stories that you would like to publish, there will be a second edition and third one and maybe even more.
Я розумію, що вона десь має якийсь вплив, як власне і я, коли дивляться на мене, я іноді ловлю на собі погляди, що як ти взагалі ходиш, що не наклав на себе руки.
I understand that it has a certain influence. Sometimes I notice people looking at me like, how is it that you are still alive? It made me a bit nervous at first, when they would hide their eyes, not knowing how to tell me to be strong. But now I'm used to that, and it even amuses me. When I'm riding on a subway train, I grab the handrail and people look at me as if I'm dead, but it does not bother me because I feel fine. That's why I think that this book is more for people who don't have such major health problems, for example. But for some reason they believe that it's the end of the world, and they will never pull out of this depressive state. But after reading that, there is a guy living without hands, writing, working. It definitely makes some sense, and I'm happy because I even mentioned in the annotation that I had no ambition as a writer, and I don't tell readers that they should be concerned about my fate to make life easier for me. I want those people who are lost and do not know what to do to continue their lives to read this book and realize that you can live in any condition. And if they can continue living, it will be worth more to me than selling 10,000 books.
Ви знаєте, аналог цієї книжки, він існує, ви його маєте пам'ятати, якщо ви приблизно одного зі мною.
You know, there is an analog of this book. You probably remember it, if you are as around the same age as me. A Tale of a True Man that Boris Polevoy wrote about the pilot Maresiev, who was also wounded and lost both his legs, but still returned to the war and life. You know, in contrast to the story of Polevoy, which is completely socialist, full of socialist pathos, full of heroism of a Soviet man, who and so on and so forth, Tereshchenko's book is very humorous. I don't understand how a person who has lived through such a tragedy can have so much self-irony. Where does he get the strength for that? And returning to our question, I'm still trying to understand how this cheerful person who survived such a tragedy remained cheerful, sincere, and continues to have a good sense of humor. Well, I hesitated for a long time. I was still afraid at the age of 47. I served in a Soviet construction battalion. That was a very military profession that I had. But when Crimea was annexed, I went to a recruitment office and said that I was ready. I probably lacked the courage to go to the volunteer battalion. There was probably a measure of mistrust in the armed forces of Ukraine, because I served in the army. So I went there. They didn't draft me for quite some time, but then one day they called and said, if you were so eager to be drafted, we'll be waiting for you tomorrow. That's how I ended up on the proving grounds of the 28th Mechanized Brigade. Also, my friend, who was at the enlistment office, said that they spent a long time choosing whether to assign me as a machine gunner or a grenadier. But then he remembered that I was a camera operator, so a grenade launcher would be closer to my skills. I used to recall him a lot while hauling around those 30 kilograms. When I got to the proving grounds, I thought it was all a game from the Soviet Union, but it would all end soon, and that I can't be killed in the 21st century because I'm a good person. People love me, I love people, and therefore it was possible that I would die at this time. Even though completely different messages arrived from the front, this is what I kept thinking about. So we spent 3 weeks at the proving grounds, shooting 3 to 5 bullets a day. And then I reached the point of feeling comfortable there. After 3 weeks, at the evening roll call, the battalion commander said at the end, it was pitch black. He was counting us with a flashlight, and at the end he said that they needed volunteers for the ATO for the next morning. It was then that I realized that it was time to make a decision. I wanted to, but was a bit slow, and my young colleague, whom I worked with on television, went there, and I felt ashamed of staying behind. It turned out that we were both assigned to serve in the 79th Air Mobile Brigade, from where we were sent to the Donbass. How does a person feel there? War is an unnatural thing, especially for a non-military man. It was stressful after living a peaceful life. It was stress on the body and on the soul. And of course, there was the subconscious fear of dying. But somehow I made myself believe that despite the fear, I was winning ground step by step. I felt shame because young men had gone through the process several times, and they weren't afraid anymore, and I looked up to them. It gradually faded into the background. Then I had one combat deployment that I considered horrible. It was my first experience of real war. 2 ambushes, injuries, and the first deaths. But as it turned out, those guys who had been in tougher situations later told me that it had always been like that. And when I ended up at the Donetsk Airport, I realized that what had been before was completely different. There is no recipe of war. Everyone reacts to it differently. A person who gets into a stressful situation cannot predict how they will behave. Some go numb and fall down. Some stand there waiting. Some run. Some are afraid, but they still perform their duties. It is stressful, it is different, and I didn't always have lightning speed reaction. Of course, there were situations when I wanted to fall down, hide somewhere in the corner and think that it was all just a dream and that it will pass. But now I know that everything happens by God's will. So what had to happen is exactly what happened. Whether you like it or not, you have to accept the fact that it happened. But again, people who are sent to fight in a war will not understand my words because it is something they must experience themselves.
Ну, от повертаючись до повісті о настоящем чоловіке, ви знаєте, Терещенко тепер ветеран.
Returning to the story of a true person, you know Терещенко is a veteran now, and he's doing a lot of veteran work. He meets with youth. But you know, if you read his book, you will immediately understand that these are not the meetings with veterans that I remember very well from the time when I went to school.
Моїх часів, коли я вчився у школі.
Well, of course, I had veteran duties from the moment I was injured. Why? Because when I was getting treatment, money was being raised for me all over the country to pay for my amputations. There was a case when a 14 or 15-year-old boy was saving money to buy a laptop. Instead, he donated this 480 hryvnias to Uncle Oleksandr for an operation on his hands. I realized then that I had no right to give up. He gave me money for the operation on my hands, and I was grateful for that. Moreover, it motivated me. Many people came to visit me, and I realized that. When you come back, you do see this gap between the war. It is both there and not there. I went to a book forum in Lviv, and there was an accident in which a citizen of Lviv died. They were supposed to take him to the central square to say goodbye. About 100 to 150 people were waiting there. Then he arrived. They said goodbye, and then they went on celebrating. Some were singing, others were laughing. Why is that? I just don't understand it. A person died. So such song, dance, and laughter is shameful. We must educate our people to show respect for the ailing and diseased. And it is up to veterans to organize this, because no one else is ready or willing to engage in such humanitarian aid for those people who need it. The Martians won't descend from outer space to protect humans on Earth. The world is becoming more and more violent, and the level of security around the world is insufficient. We must once again get used to the fact that a man must protect his home, wife, children, and his land, which is for the foremost the foundation of any country in the world. Okay, let's return from veteran work back to writing. Can we expect the continuation of your stories? Because you probably won't believe what I'm going to say, but reading this ironic and funny style of Uncle Oleksandr, whom you won't even suspect of losing both hands and an eye, is very uplifting and motivating. So will you continue to write such pleasant and emotionally positive works? Come on and entertain us, Uncle Oleksandr. This direction is completely dependent on what I do in my life. Each of my stories is simply a real-life situation, and you can't just sit and write something. Well, sometimes I come up with some philosophical things, but you won't write a book about your sensations and experiences. Even my sister, my editor, says that you need to at least be engaged in some kind of work. At first, I was working at the Academy of Patrol Police as a deputy chief, and that's from 8 to 17:30, though it suits me much more than serving as a wax work. That's exactly what I mean. Perhaps we should expect a book about the patrol police. Well, there is a story, but I am in a different position now. Can't the chief of police write books? Well, I'm not the chief. You will be one day. But what I want to say is that you should write. Write about peaceful life. Write about the police. Write about yourself. Write about us. Write, because you're really good at it. And be sure to come back to binding.